Good morning to everybody. If those of you are watching online or if you're here in person, my name is Mario. So glad that you picked a great Sunday to be with us. I'm here with our co-host, Pastor Yahara. How are you?
Great. Good morning.
All right. So it's a mild Sunday morning. The temperature is just right. And we have a lot of people coming into the building right now. But we're excited. Over the last couple of Sundays, we've began a brand new series. Pastor Bill is speaking on how to navigate different pressures in life. And so I know Pastor Justin is speaking today, so we're excited for that. And we also have a lot of child dedications today. So you'll notice a lot of different families that are here today with visitors and friends. And so we're celebrating with them today.
Yes, and it's so exciting to see so many different faces here today. And if you're here for the first time or come quite often, we would love for you to share this experience. If you're online, we have our YouTube, Facebook, and our platform for you to share. You can just hit that share button. As well, if you're in person, you snap a photo, tag us online at Central CC. Come and take a picture of me and Mario here. I don't mind. And let us know where you're watching from as well. If you're online, we would just love to hear from you.
Yes, and if you're here in person, we'd love to connect with you right after the experience. You'll notice a bunch of people with lanyards and blue shirts right here in our connections wall in the lobby. And we just love to help in any way that we can. If you have some questions about Central, what's going on, some of the activities, we'd love to just connect with you. And if you're watching online, just say hello. And there's also an opportunity for you to request prayer on the online church platform. If you're watching on Facebook or on YouTube, you can always text us at 905-937-5610. So welcome.
Yes, and if you would love to partner with the vision here at Central and want to be part of what God is doing, we have a variety of ways for you to do that. You can actually take part three ways, whether you want to give online at centralcc.ca/give or go to the giving kiosk in the lobby. We have a cash, check, or debit credit area. Feel free to come on out as well to the tip tap station here behind us at exit A, and you can tap up to 20 times your debit or credit card.
Yeah, and again, thank you so much for your generosity and being part of this vision, which is really to help you connect to God and to others. So our activities revolve around this vision, whether it's kids or youth or young adults programs or our groups that are happening throughout the region. We want you to feel welcome and have a place for you. In fact, we actually have new groups launching for the winter semester, winter season. And so here in the lobby, right after the experience, you'll find several of the leaders of the groups. And so if you're wondering what group do I fit in, you know, come and check it out. Check it out here. There's a list of different groups. And also you can interact with the leaders yourself. And if you're watching online, you can also check out our website, centralcc.ca/groups. And I want to highlight one of the groups that is starting up in February. And that is Alpha en Español, Alpha in Spanish. And so if you're Spanish speaking, we have a lot of different Spanish-speaking people here. You want to come out to that. It starts in February 10th at 7 o'clock here.
Awesome. Yeah. And another unique group that we have going on here at Central is called 21 Days of Prayer. And we have had an amazing 2 weeks of that. We're entering our final week where it's happening Monday to Friday at 6 a.m. And Saturday, you can sleep in a little till 9 a.m. You can join us in person or online. And basically what we do is we come together as a church. We have a pastor who will give a devotion. Then you split up into a 30-minute personal prayer time, come back together at the end, have some corporate sharing. And we have an online link and a devotional guide for you to check us out at centralcc.ca/21days. But what's been really encouraging about this group is what we are seeing, what God is doing, not only through the adults and with the adults, but the young people. Pastor Mario and I have been able to be witnesses to the young people sitting in the front, testifying what God is doing, hearing of the breakthroughs, hearing of what God is doing in their lives because of prayer. So if you're a person, any age, you're welcome to come to 21 Days of Prayer in our last week and just bring it home.
All right. Another thing that we've been excited about is our upcoming baptism service. We had one only a couple of months ago, but we have many more people that want to be baptized. And baptism really is just an outward expression of what God has done in your heart. So if you're following Jesus, you want to take this extra step of just recognizing that and making that public. Then if you're interested in being baptized yourself, why don't you let us know. Come and talk to us here at the connections wall, or you can sign up at centralcc.ca/baptism. And again, that's coming up on February 5th. both the 11 and the 9 a.m. experiences.
Yeah, so many exciting things happening in our wonderful church that God has given us in this space. And so if you have any questions, please feel free to text us or call us at 905-937-5610. You're also welcome to come to our events calendar online at centralcc.ca. And as well, we have so many wonderful volunteers and staff here at the Connections Wall wearing blue shirts or lanyards just like we have here. So please feel free to come on out and we'd love to serve you.
All right. Well, that's a lot, but that's all up. That's from us right now. But we're going to be opening our hearts to hear what God is saying. So I want to thank you for joining us today. We're going to head over into the auditorium now as our experience begins
right now.
Place where God's creativity is on display in this place we call home. A place where His provision is in our places of work and play. Where community is worth fighting for. We see a place where His beauty is in the diversity of those who choose to live here. Where trust is forged. We see a place where His goodness is found in the kindness of neighbors and friends. Where purpose is reclaimed. And as the church, we are in the center of what He is doing in this region. A place where faith is our anchor. We are a place where truth is championed. We are a place where hope is our focus. We are a place where love always wins. This is a place for you.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to church. Welcome to Central. If you're joining us online, thank you so much. Be able to stand. Please stand. Sing along. We're going to sing about joy this morning. We need your help.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory.
Let's go.
There's joy in the house to the Lord. There's joy in the house to the Lord today. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Give me praise.
We sing.
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause He opened on that cross, then He rose up from that grave. My God still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Shout out your praise.
Hands up. This is my favorite part. Let's declare this together. Come on.
We were the beggars.
of the Lord, sing praise again. We were new beggars, and now we're royalty. We were new prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. So let the house of the Lord sing praise. We give Him praise. Oh, oh, oh. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out Your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, no. We'll shout out Your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out.
The joy in this place. And since we started singing that song today, I've just sensed the hope that God brings as we worship Him, as we focus on Him. So let's continue doing that.
We're creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. And then from north to south,
creature finds its inmost melody.
to be in your presence today. To know you here with us and to know what you've done for us and how we could be standing here with all the hope in the world on our side and driving us today. Thank you, God, for your presence. I just want to encourage you today. I have so much hope in saying this. I have so much hope for us. I have so much hope for this year. I don't know why I'm walking in this year with great expectation more than I have last year, but I don't know, God is working in me through 21 days of prayer. And I know he's revealing things to you as well, of course, as we, you know, take the time to hear from him. That's what happens. He comes running and he reveals things to our hearts. But for me, I just have so much hope for you. I have so much hope for us. And I know it stems, and I know you know it stems, and it starts with surrender. And with this, with worship to God, and then surrendering of our lives. But in doing so, I have so much hope for victory for you in your life. In whatever area that you are you're surrendering to him, I believe with you. I believe for you. And if you don't believe that for yourself today, I just want you to know there's someone on your side, that God's put this faith in me, and I hope to lead you that way, knowing that he is good. He's a good God. So as we sing this next song, I just know that likely he's going to speak to you, each and everyone individually, and point to something in your life. We want to make room for God in our lives, for him to move. Whatever he has for you today is better than what you can foresee for yourself. And it's good. Because God can only be good. That's the only thing he can be, is good. So would you trust him today with your life, with your dreams, with your actions?
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and out. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. Jesus, oh, we trust you. Here is where
I lay.
Whatever you want to.
God, this is my prayer. And I want to declare, I want to say that I trust you. Because of all the memories I have that are coming to my brain right now, all the memories, knowing of how good you've been, how faithful you've been. And you weave the way for me so far in a way I could not weave for myself. I could not plan for myself. And it's way better than I thought it could be. And so, of course, for the future, how could I not believe? How could we not trust you, God? How could we not? So yeah, like the song says, we pray against lies and doubts that would come in to distract, that would take away from our hope in you, God. Our faith in you, God. Would you give us the courage for that next step? And would we only focus on that next right step with you, God? And would you reveal yourself in a powerful way, in a way that we just, all we can do is smile and be like, God did that. How good you are. And you only know how to be good. Amen. Amen. I'm going to keep hoping with you, hoping for you. And if you walk into this place on a Sunday and you don't feel that for yourself, then this is the right place for you to be. This is where faith can be raised up in you, can rise up when we don't have it. We're surrounded by people who are singing these powerful words with us. All you can do is leave full of hope. And I hope that is true for you today. And I believe that for you. I invite you now to grab a seat as we continue. Thanks so much for singing so passionately with us today. Now we're going to celebrate our babies, and we're so excited to do that.
What is child dedication? At Central, we dedicate rather than baptize children. We see baptism as a reflection of an individual's decision to follow Jesus. It's why we wait to baptize children until they are old enough to understand and believe. Today, this is simply a commitment before God and our church family to raise up a child in the way of God, as we read in Proverbs 22, verse 6. It is a way to acknowledge our children not as our own, but rather as belonging to God. He created them, and He has a great plan for them. Lastly, it is a partnership. It is an opportunity for our church to commit to doing everything in our power to foster an environment where children can grow up to be who God has called them to be. So today, we follow in the example of Jesus, who took the children in His arms, and He blessed them.
What an exciting morning where we get to have child dedication. Isn't that exciting? Yes, you can clap. We are here to celebrate with these parents. And you know, just like we were watching, child dedication is this amazing moment when the church gets to stand alongside you as moms and dads and support you and encourage you and help you on this journey. And this is just a great, I love that picture. Have you ever seen where Jesus has all the kids on his lap and around him and everything? And I just think that is the perfect picture, because that is what Jesus wants, right? He says, let the kids come to me, let them come to me. And so this morning it's really great because we get to celebrate that. And we see these children coming to Jesus, and we have the honor and privilege to pray for them and alongside their parents and their families that are here today. And so first, I would love to introduce you to Amos Joseph. Amos, it is great to have you here. I'm so glad you brought your mom and dad, Diana and Joseph, with you. Yes. And I'm sure you have a lot to say. And Amos, we are going to pray for you this morning, okay? Lord Jesus, I thank you for Amos. I thank you that he is a child of yours. Lord, that you have created this very special boy who you have called to serve you. And Lord, I just pray that he would come to know you in a real and personal way at such a young age, that he would serve you all the days of his life, that he would follow after you. And not only that, but he would lead others to follow you. That's right. And so we pray these things just like you said, Amos. Amen. Amen. And next, we have this precious little one, Anastasia Isabella, Isabel. And we have her parents with us, Emily and Alex. And Anastasia, your name means resurrection. And that is a pretty powerful name when you think of resurrection, meaning like all things coming back to life. And I think you just have this amazing title where you are going to call people to life and stir up things that maybe they never even realized before. And so will you join me in praying for Anastasia this morning? Lord, I thank you for Anastasia. I thank you for the gift of her life and for her mom, Emily and Alex. Lord, I thank you that you have called them to raise this beautiful girl. And so, Lord, we just ask that she would know you, who you are, and how much you love her. I pray that she would follow you in everything she does. And just as her name speaks resurrection, things coming to life, I pray that everything she touches, every person she meets would come to life deep inside. And so we thank you for her. We thank you for her life. And Lord, I just pray a blessing over Emily and Alex as they raise her, as they impart their wisdom, and as they are there for her all the days of her life. And so we thank you for them today in Jesus' name. And next we have Celine Daniela. You're gonna face everyone and look out here. And Celine, your name, heavenly, God is my judge. What a powerful name. And I was actually looking at this, and you know what words came to me was confidence in who you are. And I think that is something we wanna pray into you from this age, because that is something so many of us struggle with. And your name is already speaking that, right? So let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for Celine. I thank you, Lord, that she is just this beautiful creation of you. I thank you that you have already called her to be heavenly. What a powerful name. And Lord, I think of confidence in who you have created her to be. And so I just pray, Jesus, that she would know you as her personal friend, as her savior, that Lord, that she would grow with the confidence of knowing that you are always there for her, that you have called her to great things and you are with her every step of the way. And Lord, I just pray for her mom and dad, that you would give them power and strength and wisdom in everything they do. Lord, that they would share their love for you with her, and they would just be amazing examples. And I thank you for her in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, oh, you're going to look away, are you? Well, this is Stone Tiberius, and his name means dweller by the rock or river. And that is a pretty powerful name. And I was actually looking at this too. And you know, when they talk about dweller by the rock, they talk about these little animals that burrow into rocks and they live there and they are safe. And I think of how you could be that safe refuge for so many people. Yes, I know. Look at those eyes. And so we're going to pray that stone over you. And we're going to pray for Tiffany and Arthur too, your mom and dad. And Lord, today I just thank you so much for Stone. I thank you for this name, Dweller of the Rock. Lord, and just as you are our powerful refuge and strength, I pray that Stone would grow up to be a powerful refuge and strength for every person that he meets, that you would use him to protect others, because when they meet him, they're gonna meet you and they're gonna know who you are. And so, Lord, I pray for strength and wisdom for his mom and dad, Lord, as they raise him to know you, as they walk alongside him in every day. I pray, Lord, that you would give them everything that they need. And so, Lord, we just pray this blessing on Stone today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Will you give us a round of applause for our parents today? Aren't they amazing? It's so awesome. It is so much fun to celebrate child dedication. And you know, I look forward to over the years as we see these guys in Central Kids and watching what happens and what God does in their life. We have this amazing opportunity to invest in them. And I know there's many of you who volunteer in Central Kids and you're here to support as well because we are in this together, right? And so I want to introduce you to James Alexander. That's you, right? Were you looking at your picture up there? So we have James Alexander and his mom and dad, Helen and Mario. And your name, it says, means may God protect. And you know what? I like that second line, defender of man. You already look like a good defender of man, right? Well, we're going to pray for you this morning, James. Lord, I thank you so much for James. I thank you that he is already a strong and powerful guy. In Jesus' name, and I pray that his walk with you would be firm, it would be strong, it would be faithful. And Lord, I just pray that you would give him strength, that as he defends what he knows is right and just, as he follows your way, I pray, Lord, you would equip him, that you would cause him to be powerful and a leader in everything that he touches. May it flourish and grow. And I thank you, Lord, that you have called him to great things already, even at a young age. And so we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, this is a beautiful name, Summer. And it's not hard to see Summer in your face because you are so bright and so beautiful. Summer Ann. And the name means the beauty of sought after, the beauty of sought after and grace, which is just so awesome. Who doesn't want to seek after Summer? And mom and dad, Deanne and Michael. And so we're going to pray for you, Summer, today. So Lord, I thank you for Summer. I thank you for this beautiful, bright light. And I think of that summer season that we always look forward to. And Lord, what an amazing thing that her mom and dad get to experience summer every single day. And so I pray, Lord, that your grace would be so full in her life. I pray that you would call her to great things, that you would equip her for every single thing. And just like the light and the sun are so bright in the summer, I pray that your light would shine through her everywhere she goes and people would just be drawn to her and they would come out of darkness and into light because she is a follower of you, Jesus, the light of the world. And so, Lord, I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And Kai is just peaceful and quiet this morning. And his name, Kai Nathan, a gift from God. And so let's pray for Kai. Kai, we just bring you before you. Bring Kai before you today, Lord. And I thank you that Kai is a gift from you. I thank you, Lord, that you have already called him, that you have already spoken his name on your lips, Lord. I thank you that you are God who knows his children so well, and you already see well into his years. And Lord, we just pray this morning that Kai would be a man that would search after your heart. He would follow your ways. He would walk in your steps. I pray, Lord, not only that, but he would lead others to walk in your step. And I pray for his mom and dad, Lord, as they invest in him, as they teach him, as they encourage him, as they walk his days with him, Lord, may you give them the strength and the wisdom that they need. And so, Lord, I thank you for this family. And Lord, we just pray a special blessing on Kai today. And we just look forward to seeing great things in him and through him in the following days. And we just pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you join me in giving our families a round of applause?
Good morning. How are you today? Woo! Amazing. This crew is doing really good right here. Buffalo, there you go. That's great. Great to have you with us, and especially if you're here supporting somebody being dedicated today. I just love these moments. I think there's something about family that is what we were made for, and it doesn't always happen that way in our biological families, but this is what the family of God is all about. And if you're new to Central, that's what it is. It's a family. And so welcome. Glad that you're here. Thank you for being here to support some of these beautiful babies. Today, I want to start with a bit of a story. A number of years ago, my wife and I were, we had been married a few years, and we were on an anniversary trip, our first time to Italy. Okay, we have some Italians here today. Yeah. I know, you're not very proud of yourselves, I know. And you should be, because your country's amazing. Anyways, we were in Italy, and it was amazing. We had this incredible time, and we had planned our trip in such a way that we were going to spend some time in Venice, and then we were going to spend some time in Rome, and that was the time that we had. And so we had planned it that we were going to take a night train from Rome back to Venice in order that we could fly home the following morning, in order that the next day we could take and fly to another place where we were going to shoot a wedding. And not like shoot as in like we're not hired gunmen. I mean, we are photographers. Just want to clarify that. Sorry if that was unclear. We were going to be photographers at a wedding. We did that at that time. And so we had scheduled this series of events kind of perfectly that we would get there and all would be well. And we came to the end of our trip, and sure enough, it was our last day. We were in Rome, and we had kind of planned our day so that we would do some fun things in the morning, and then we would take a bus to a subway, and a subway to the night train, and a night train to the plane, and a plane to home. This was our schedule. And so that day, we went to, you know, packed up all our stuff, and we went to get on the bus, and the bus was nowhere to be found. And this was before the days of Google on your phone. If you can remember those days, you didn't travel with a phone because even if you had one, it didn't really do much for you when you were traveling. And so we waited. We realized, you know, we talked to some people. We realized we missed the first bus. And so anyways, we got on the second bus. All was well. We thought we got lots of time, no problem. So we take the bus and we get to the subway, and we, you know, we're lugging all of our stuff with us. We have those travel backpacks, both of us, and we get on the subway. And we realized that there's a lot of stops in order to get to the train. And in fact, there's a dozen stops, and each of these stops, every time that we stopped, was another 5 minutes. The doors would stay open for 5 minutes, and then they would close. And we started doing the math on this whole endeavor, and we realized that this subway was going to arrive at the exact minute that our train was supposed to leave. And our train was going to leave and spend overnight, you know, to Venice, and then Venice we were going to fly, and then if we were going to miss that flight, we would miss this next flight the next day, and this bride would be very unhappy with us. And so we're starting to stress out, we're sweating, and as a ginger, my ears started to get red. That's what happens to us when we begin to stress out. Things just redden. Our necks get red, our ears get red, hair gets redder, and I'm stressing out. I'm sweating, okay? Things are not looking good in the ginger world over here. So anyhow, we're like, you know, we're praying, we're like speaking in, you know, tongues. We're just saying like, Lord, just please close these doors. Like we got to get there. And so we get to this train station. Finally, it's the exact minute our train is supposed to leave. Mel's not feeling good. I don't know why. I can't remember. Things are getting foggier as I'm getting older. She wasn't feeling good. All I know is I grab her backpack. I put it on my front. I have my backpack on my back, and we're booking it. There's this like really long hallway. and I'm just sweating profusely. It's a bad, bad scene in the Drieger household. And we get to the end of this hallway. We go up the set of stairs. Don't ask me why there's no escalator, but I'm now exhausted. I'm running up the stairs, and we get to the top of the stairs, and there's nobody there. Nobody there. It's an empty area. There's literally nobody there except for two Italian guys drinking coffee. And so we're looking around. There's a few signs, but we can't read them. There's no Google Maps. There's no Google Translate app. There's no people to ask questions to. Just these two Italian guys drinking coffee, retired, living their best life. And so we're pointing at our ticket like we're looking for this train. And they look at us like we're crazy. So unhelpful, those Italians. Just so unhelpful. I'm just kidding. They're great people, great people. We have a lot of staff on our team that are Italian. So if you're wondering why I'm a little bit bothersome to the Italians, that's why. Anyways, so we're on the train station and we're looking around. There's nothing to do. There's nobody we could talk to, nobody we could ask questions to, nobody we could call, nobody getting on trains. And we had this moment, and I'll never forget this moment, where we were at a loss. We didn't know what to do. We didn't know where to go. We didn't know who to turn to. We couldn't call. We couldn't ask anybody. And I'll never forget that feeling. It was like a dead end. We didn't know what to do. And fortunately, down the road, we looked, and there was a train far, far off in the distance. Turned out that train was delayed, and we made it home, and we made our flight home, and we made it to that wedding, and everything worked out. But that moment is burned into my memory as one of those moments where I was at a loss. I just didn't know what to do. And I was thinking about our lives for most of us, life is really great until it's not, right? Like, life is pretty good. As long as we're moving forward and things are happening, life is pretty great until it's not. And that translates really across all of our, areas of our lives. Maybe it's in your job. Your job is really great until when? It's not. Until that job used to provide what you needed, and all of a sudden it's not anymore. Or parenting is really great until it's not, right? Until that child rebels or makes a decision that has a lot of consequences and you're just devastated because you know what this means for them. Parenting's really great until it's not. Or friendship is really great until somebody believes the worst of you, or they misinterpret your intentions, or it becomes something and now you're at an impasse and you can't go forward. It's the same thing in our relationships, in our marriage, in our dating relationships. Those are really great until you're at an impasse and you're not sure how you're gonna move forward, right? Life is really great until it's not. And I realize for a lot of us, we find ourselves sometimes in life at a place where we don't know what to do. We are at an impasse. We're at a place of uncertainty where we're questioning and we don't know which way to go. And maybe the path that we thought we should be on, we're now questioning, is this actually the right path for me? I've been doing this path for some time and I'm not sure it's the right path. Or everyone else seems very convinced this is the path for you, but now you are no longer sure that it is. Or that path that you're on now used to work for you, but you've grown and you've changed and that path no longer works for you. It doesn't fit your worldview. It doesn't fit the things that you want. So what do you do when you find yourself at a place that you don't want to be? What do you do when you're uncertain? What do you do when you feel like you're stuck? That's what I want to talk about today. And we have a name for this in our culture. Our culture just calls this a midlife crisis, right? That place when you're 50, 60, 70 years old, and you're not sure what to do anymore. You're questioning all of this. But actually what we're gonna see today is that every single one of us, we battle this. Whether you're 15 or you're 50, whether you're 16 or you're 60, anywhere in between or above or beyond, that there's this thing that happens in us that we hit an impasse, we hit a blockage, we hit a place of uncertainty, questioning, unsure of what to do. And that's what this series has been all about. What do you do when you feel pressed? And so I'm really excited. Week one, Pastor Bill, if you weren't with us, did a great job of just talking about setting the foundation. When you're pressed, this idea that you can push back. It's not the end for you. You can push back. And so I want to encourage you to go back and check that out. Last week, Pastor Bill talked about when you're pressed, what is expressed? And I love that image. I was thinking of how many of you are coffee drinkers? You're the coffee lovers. Okay, that idea of like an espresso. Okay, we can thank the Italians for that one. But that idea of when you express a bean, that when that bean has been grown in great environment, and in the right altitude and with the right soil, and that bean has been roasted by a master roaster, when you express it, what comes out? This beautiful oils and floating solids and the crema, and there's this like beautiful like espresso layers. Like it's awesome, right? Some of you are just craving caffeine right now as I talk about it. But when you express a bad bean, a bean that's grown in bad conditions, that's been burnt from Starbucks. Just throwing that out there. Or Tim Hortons, whatever you hate more, you know? When you express a bad bean, what comes out? Something that tastes bitter or sour. And so this idea that we can allow it to shape us. I'm really excited. Next week, we have Steve Abma with us. He's a clinical psychotherapist from our church. He's a counselor. He's gonna talk a lot about just some really practical tools about how you can navigate pressure from a mental capacity, from a counselor's perspective. So really excited. If you wanna just learn a little bit more, be here for that, put that on your calendar. But today, I wanna talk about the art of becoming unstuck. The art of becoming unstuck. I think if there was a word to describe what a lot of us feel in our culture, the climate, in the conversations that we're having, in the circle of like the things we keep coming up against, we keep coming up into, is this word is stuck, this word stuck. We're talking about the same things. We're uncertain about the future. We're unsure that our kids will have the opportunities that we had. We're unsure that the path that we're on is gonna lead us to what we want. We're unsure about our leaders or our leadership. We're unsure about church. We're unsure about things that we wanna go to, things we don't wanna go to. We have a lot of questions and we don't have a lot of answers. And in that place, it's easy to get stuck there, not sure the way forward. And so we've been anchored in what I believe is a passage that's gonna help us navigate how do we move forward. Because God's plan for you is for you to have a future. To a future where you prosper, and not because everything went well. We're gonna see actually the opposite is true sometimes, and today we're gonna see that as well. But God's idea for you is a future, and it is good. So that's where we're going today. So if you come into this place stuck, questioning, uncertain, not sure the direction forward, I wanna encourage you today that there's some practical tools. And if you're not in that place, if you're doing really great, I want you to write these down, because there's gonna come a time when you will face the hard night of the soul. And you're gonna look, how do I face this? How do I move forward? I wanna give you some really practical tools on how to do that. So, if you have a Bible, turn with me. We're gonna go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. It'll be on the screen as well, but I wanna encourage you to read along with me if you have an app or a Bible with you. And we're gonna read it together. Here's what it says. It says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay. In this story, jars of clay, we are the jars of clay, we are the vessel. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and it's not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side. I don't know if you feel that today, but this is the reality. This is the promise that you will be, if you're not already, hard-pressed. We are hard-pressed on every side, but we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not abandoned. And we're struck down, and we're not destroyed. I want to focus on a little chunk here of this passage. It says that we're perplexed, but we're not in despair. And that's kind of a weird word, because we don't use that word too often, but I got a little bit nerdy this week, and I did a deep dive into this little section, and it's fascinating. There's a really cool wordplay that happens here, but this word perplexed comes from the Greek word poros, which means passageway. And this is how a lot of us, I think, work and navigate our lives. We think about our lives in this way, that it's a journey. And for us, this word poros carries with it the connotation that we attach deep meaning to moving forward, to the journey from one place to the next. And whenever something happens that is an obstacle, we wanna know what? Why? Right? Why did that happen to me? Why did I have to go through that? Why is the world like it is? Why are you like you are, right? This is what my children say to me, Dad. Dad, why are you like you are? I'm just your dad. I'm now not cool anymore, right? Why are you like you are? This is what we want to attach meaning to the destination. And whenever there's something that stops us, that's what is perplexing. Why am I stuck on this journey? And what's interesting is these two words, perplexed and despair, are actually from the same word. The only difference is that there's a prefix on the word despair, and it means to be totally perplexed. It means to be at your end, to be broken, to be past the point of return, that there is, you're given over to a broken mind. It's like there's no more worrying, uncertainty. It's just you're at the end, your point of no return. And so Paul is saying this. He's saying, you will have obstacles. And I don't know the version of God that maybe you were sold, or maybe that there was a belief that you adopted that if you knew God, that all of your problems would go away. How many have had that happen in your life? You came to a knowledge of God, and as a result, you have no more problems. Is anybody here? Okay, great. That's great. No liars. That's fantastic. Great job. But that's the reality, right? Your problems didn't go away. That was never the promise. The promise is you will have obstacles. You will be perplexed. You will face the dark night of the soul. You will be uncertain, and you will question things. But there is a way to get through it. There's an art to becoming unstuck, and that's what I want to talk about today. How do you do that? So three things I want to talk about today. There's really three ideas I think we're going to pull from this story, and the first one is going to sound incredibly basic, but it's one of the most important ones, and it's this, that you must acknowledge it. You must acknowledge it. It sounds awfully simple, but this is probably one of our biggest things. We often find ourselves living in denial, or we say, I'm fine, but there's something about acknowledging it. What I've learned in my own life, for those of you that maybe don't know me too well, I grew up very Mennonite heritage. That's my roots. And if you don't know a lot about the Mennonites, there's some things that we're known for and some things that we are good at and some things that we're very bad at. The things that we're good at are hard work, physical, like farming. We farmed land, you know, and my heritage is we farmed land that nobody else could, and great workers. My heritage is that a lot of the Mennonites found faith, and church was very important to them, and family was very important around the things of God, and they had an experience with God that was beautiful, and they really wanted to preserve that. But then the area that we really struggle is in emotions, hugging, physical affection, expressing how we feel. And so I remember when we first got married, my wife and I, we would have these painful arguments, and they were painful because it was like a lot of time where I would just be quiet. I didn't have words to express how I felt, right? And so sometimes days later, I'd be like, hey, I was thinking about how I feel about that thing we were talking about. And she'd be like, what? What did we talk about? That was days ago, right? And it was like deep waters for me. And the point of the story is I learned that I had to clumsily work through it. I had to acknowledge what it was I was going through, acknowledge what I was facing. And as I did that, you know what I learned? Is that a lot of people went through the same thing that I did, or were going through the same thing that I did. A lot of people knew somebody who was going through something that I did, and I was able to see that often it wasn't as big of a deal as I thought, being able to acknowledge it. So very practical. But also, there's something very spiritual about acknowledging your obstacle, acknowledging your setback. There's something about voicing it. The Bible uses this word confession. That there's this idea that when you speak things out loud, you have an opportunity for healing. You can experience the path of healing and life again when you express it. And I love it because Jesus actually modeled what this looked like for us. If you go with me to Matthew chapter 26, Jesus, he's in the Garden of Gethsemane. And what I really love about the Bible is that nothing is by accident. And so in this story, the Garden of Gethsemane actually means oil pressed. Really neat. That's important because he's about to be pressed. It's the hard night of the soul for Jesus. And so Jesus, he goes and he says this to his disciples. He's about to go pray. And here's what he says in verse 38 of chapter 26. He says, my soul is overwhelmed. My soul is overwhelmed. I just want to pause on that for a second because maybe that's where you're at today. Online or in person here, you just feel like, I just don't even know how to face that thing. I was backstage, I was just thinking about that song we were singing. That God, you would just break down anything that's gonna hold me back from knowing you. I wanna make room for you because your best is for me. And this is that place Jesus is in. He's overwhelmed. He's overwhelmed. He doesn't know fully what to do. And he's willing to be vulnerable as the Son of God to model to us what this looks like. And he says, my soul's overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. And then it says, going a little further, he fell to the ground face down. And this is what he prayed. He prayed, my Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. And so he does this three times, over and over. He says, God, not my will, yours be done. God, please take this away from me. This is too hard, but not my will, yours be done. And I was thinking about this. This kind of struck me this week, that for a lot of us, we understand wills, right? We have a will to do something. And one of the ways that we understand wills is typically a negative connotation. We have a battle of the wills, right? How many of you have children? How many are sitting beside them and they are strong-willed children or were strong-willed and now things are good, but growing up, like they had a will, right? Some of you have kids like that or you have a boss that you work with and it's like you understand this concept of a battle of wills, right? One person has a will, another one, and you're gonna battle it out to see who's gonna win the battle of the wills. And what Jesus is modeling for us, because I was looking at this passage and I thought, what's happening here? It's not a battle of wills. This is something more beautiful. This is an exchange of wills. This is an exchange. This is the idea predicated on trust that maybe, just maybe, God's will is better than mine. This idea that Jesus says, my flesh is weak, but my spirit is strong. My flesh is weak, I don't want this. What I want is not to drink this cup, but God, you're strong, you're good, you're working it out. You're doing something bigger than even just me. You're doing something for all of humanity. God, not my will, but yours be done. There's this beautiful exchange that takes place. And it starts, I know for some of you, faith is a new idea. And so for you, the idea of even trusting God is a bizarre idea because you're like, I can't see him and I don't know if I can. But is it worth exploring? And my case would be that I think it is. In fact, my experience is that it is. It's better because I've been able to see that there's more. There's something better on the other side, that the way through is expressed through this pressing, strength, and courage. Because what happens to Jesus? An angel shows up and gives him strength to face what he needed to do. And I think alternatively, the challenge for a lot of us is that Jesus is also a gentleman. God is a gentleman. He's not gonna force you to do anything that you don't wanna do. And so we read about the story. Paul writes about it in Romans. He said there's a group of people that didn't want to have God's will. It says that they exchanged God's image for human image. And as a result, God gave them over to a depraved mind, total perplexity. They reached their end. There was something that began to happen. They began to destroy themselves. And this is what happens when we're outside of God's best for us. We begin to make decisions that aren't the best. We don't choose the best. And so this year, as I was thinking about starting this year, I know for a lot of us, we have New Year's resolutions. And we start and we wanna say, you know, these are all the things that I wanna do. I wanna, you know, make this amount of money. I wanna look this certain way in my body. I wanna achieve these goals. We have these goals. And I thought, what if we could start the year differently? This is what I was convicted with at our 21 days of prayer. What if instead of starting the year with what do I want, what if we could start with, God, what do you want for me? God, what do you want for me? Because here's what I believe. I believe God's will for you is a perfect, pleasing, and good will. He has the best for you. It doesn't mean that it's gonna be easy, but he is good. He's good. He's good. And so today I wanna ask you as you start this year, and if you feel stuck or if you feel uncertain or you feel confused, the first step is you gotta acknowledge it. You gotta acknowledge it, speak it out. Second thing I want to talk about today is as you find yourself stuck, the way forward is to embrace hard things. Okay, so this would be my most unpopular point today. Embrace hard things. This is a countercultural idea. And I like how James puts it in James chapter 1, verse 2. He says this. He says, consider it pure joy when you face hard things. How many like this verse? How many have joy when you go through hard things, right? Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of any kind, because why? Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, and let perseverance finish its work so that you may become mature and complete, not lacking anything. For if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it'll be given to you. You see, I think there's something about us becoming who we were made to be is not the easy path. It was never promised that it would be, but the path to you becoming exactly who God has made you to be is a harder path. The Bible calls it the narrow path. It's a harder path. I've actually been reading a book recently. It's not a Christian book, but it's a book a friend recommended to me called, it's called The Comfort Crisis. That's the name of it. Lost that for a second. Comfort Crisis. And it's based on this idea that you and I are living longer lives than we've ever lived, but less healthy lives than we've ever lived. And that you and I are experiencing something in the last 100 years that has never been experienced in all of history, which is that we are not, to our core, fundamentally challenged anymore with the basic things, right? You go to bed and you have a climate-controlled bedroom. With your app, you can turn the heat up and down. You have a nice soft bed with a silk sheet pillow case, which is a thing now, I guess. My wife has one of them. Anyways, you know, when we go to bed and we wake up and we have a climate-controlled morning with a food that was in a bag from somebody that they made for us, and then we get into our climate-controlled vehicle and we go to our climate-controlled work in front of our screen, and we get food that's delivered to us that somebody drives to us, and then the other person brings everything on Prime to us at our house. When we get home, it's there. And then we drive home and we eat that food from a bag that somebody gathered and harvested and you know, bought for us and brought for us. And then we have thousands of hours of, you know, entertainment on our TV, and then we rinse and repeat. And we could go through our entire lives not really ever fundamentally challenged. And we're actually, what's cool about the book is it's this stark reality that, and a challenge for us, that we're not actually living up to our potential. For so many of us, we have this massive opportunity to live these great lives, but we settle for just a small dinner plate of opportunity. And so I was thinking about this idea that, you know, for a lot of us, and I'm speaking to myself, that the easy way isn't the best way. The easy way isn't the best way. We were actually talking on our exec team this week, just interesting, you know, as we're looking at some of the things that happened this last year. And what we found actually was about, so this is just an interesting statistic for you, that 100% of you that were in groups this year, about 50 to 60% of you attended a group more than 4 times. So 100% of you attended 1 time, only about 50 to 60% attended more than 4 times. And what we're seeing is that that's actually an indicator of what's happening really in our culture, that the minute there's a small thing or a hard thing, and again, we all have different reasons. I'm not saying it's bad or good. We have our reasons, but there are these things that there's something, when something's hard, we seem to be a lot easier to give up on the things that are difficult. And the story of the Bible is that there are going to be hard things, but take heart, I've overcome the world. The story of the Bible is that you're gonna face difficult things, but don't worry, I'm gonna give you the strength and the courage to get through it. And so if embracing hard things meant that you could become who God has made you to be, would you take them? Would you do them? And this is where I think we're invited into. We're invited into more. There's something more for us. And so it requires us to embrace hard things. And then the third thing is this, is that in order for us to move from stuck to our preferred future, it's gonna require that we constantly evaluate our mindsets. Constantly evaluate our mindsets. I don't know if you're like me, but there are things that I think and believe that aren't always necessarily true. What I think is not necessarily true. And it may not be the best thing for me. Evaluate your mindset, hold tightly to the truth, and hold loosely to the rest. So how do you do that? How do you do that? Romans 12 verse 2 says this. It says, do not conform to the patterns of this world, but instead what? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Bible reminds us that there is something about constantly reminding ourselves what is true that we have to do, because our drift is to the natural, our drift is to the things that don't bring life. And so I got thinking about this. What is it that I fundamentally believe is true? Have you ever thought about that question? What is it at the end of the day, if somebody pressed you and you said, what do you fundamentally believe is true? And I realize there's two things. The first one is that God is sovereign. That's a big Christian word. What does that mean? It just means that God is going to work it out for good. I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't necessarily always like the method, I don't always like the timing, but I know that God ultimately is trustworthy, and that's a process. And that over my life, I've come to realize that there's people that went before me who had faith for me, and now I have faith for others. This idea that God is actually trustworthy and he is working it out for his good. And that's why I can be confused, but not in despair. I can be doubting, but not in despair. I can be confused, but not confounded. I can be lost, but never losing everything. I can be in this place where I know I'm going through the hard night, but I'm becoming who I was meant to be. And that's why we can have joy. We can have joy in the hard things because you are becoming who you're meant to be. And what a perspective shift to go, you know what? This is really hard right now with my kids. This is really hard right now in my situation. This is really hard in my culture. This is hard in my home. This is hard in my work. But I'm becoming who I was meant to be. Thank you, God, for that. I have joy in that. I'm becoming mature and complete, not lacking anything. What a perspective shift. This is what we're invited into. So what do you hold tightly to that's true? And the promise, I think, I wish I could tell you that the promise of God is that everything would be easy. It's just not. It's not. In fact, sometimes faith makes it harder. Because we know God, and yet like the story of Job, Job goes through all of these hard things and loses everything, and he struggles to understand, God, why am I going through all of this, and what does he come through at the end with this idea that the only way for me to understand all of this is if I was God, and I'm not him, so I have to trust him. I'm gonna trust him, and God, as a result, he restores him, and he brings him through, and he comes out with twice the blessing he ever had. And so this is the reminder that we have this need to understand and comprehend chaos because we want answers and crave meaning, and it's unsatisfying when we don't. But it's because we're not God. We can't always understand it, but we can know that he's good. He's good. We can know that he's good. He's working it out for his good. And then the second part of that is, what else do I know? I know that his way is love. His way is love. And we talk about this every week, and it's almost painful sometimes. Because you're like, yeah, you say the same thing every week. Yes, 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 we do. We say the same thing because the way forward, God's love is the way forward. God's love is the answer to hurt, accepting and giving it. God's love is the answer to betrayal. God's love is the answer to uncertainty. God's love is the answer to my questions. God's love is the answer when I don't know which way to go. To pain, to brokenness, to darkness, accepting it and giving it. And I think that's why Paul writes it this way. He says, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So, today, I was thinking about, for those of you that came in and you're unsure of what you need to do, you're unsure of the path forward, I want to come full circle to the beginning of this passage because it says that we are not powerless, that there is a power that surpasses all understanding. There's a power that surpasses all understanding from God that's in us, and that he gives us the strength to face the day. And so I don't know what you feel today. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're experiencing. I don't know your questions, and I don't know your doubts, and I don't know the things that you find yourself confused about, but I do know this, is that God's love is the way forward. It's the way forward. It's the only way that I'm gonna be at my best. It's the only way God's gonna restore me to be an agent of healing to those that need it in this world. That God's love is the only way that's gonna restore our community to bring healing where there's brokenness. It's the only way that we're gonna engage and heal the Niagara region and heal our land. It's by simply saying, God, I receive your love and I give it. And so these are the two things I know. God's working it out for good, but also God's love is the way forward. So for you today, I wanna challenge you with this idea that we're not at the end. You're not at your end, that you don't have to stay stuck, that whatever you feel, that whatever you're facing or whatever you will face, that there is a path forward, and God's invitation is that you look to him, that you acknowledge it, you exchange your will for his. Now that's the first step. You gotta acknowledge it. You gotta exchange your will for his. God, I want your best for me. It's a process of trust. It also means that we embrace hard things. It means that we go to him and we say, God, would you make me mature and complete, that I receive this as joy because I'm becoming who you made me to be. And then lastly, we hold to what is only true. We constantly are looking at our minds. We're evaluating, what is it that I believe that's true, it isn't true, and I hold on to the things that are absolutely true, and I let go of the rest. And so today I bless you with this truth that, yeah, you're pressed, but you're not crushed. You're pressed, but you're not crushed. It's not the end for you. That you are perplexed, but you're not in despair. You haven't reached the end. You're just going through a hard thing, and God is shaping you, and he's working it out. And allow him to do that shaping, because you're becoming who you're meant to be. That you may be crushed, or you may feel like you're being crushed. You may be persecuted, but you're not abandoned. You may be struck down, and you're not destroyed. And so whatever you feel like you're going through today, I want to just pray for you of a special blessing, that God would give you exactly what you need, that he would remind you that he's shaping you into that person. And so why don't we take a moment and just pray together. God, we just come before you today, and I thank you for the beautiful aspect of family that we get to be a part of every single week. And God, I know that there's people that are here today that maybe are watching online or here in person, and God, you know what they're facing. You know exactly the night of the soul that they're experiencing. And God, I know this about you, that you are bringing light into the darkness, that you are bringing strength when we are weak, that your promise is that when we acknowledge our need for you, God, you come and you meet us. And so I pray for anyone who's just in need today, that they would start by just acknowledging it. They would be honest. God, they would say, not my will, but yours be done. I pray that you would also give us the courage, Lord, to embrace the hard things. God, there's things that you're calling us to. For some, it's a business. For some, it's a perspective change in the way that they conduct business. For some, it's how they're interacting with their family or their loved ones. God, I pray that you would help us to endure those hard things, knowing, God, that we are becoming who you've made us to be. And then, God, I pray that we would cling to truth, that you would renew our minds again to the things that are true. And the truth is that you are trustworthy, that you are working it out for good, and that your love is the way forward. And I pray that you'd help us to be the kind of people that embrace that, that as we leave this place, that we'd be people, God, who are more filled with your love than when we came, that it would be the thing that overflows out of our lives, and it would be the thing that brings healing, God, to a world that needs it, to a world that is stuck. Would we be agents that help them become unstuck? So I just pray a special blessing on our church today. I pray that in the powerful name of Jesus, amen. Amen. I want to encourage you today, if you came in and you just need some prayer, or you're going through something you'd like to navigate with somebody, it just helps to talk it out loud. We have a prayer team that's coming up right now that'll be here along the front. And we also have pastors at our connections. Well, we'd love to pray with you. Same thing online as well. Some of our online hosts, if you need prayer, just hit the request prayer button, and we'd love to pray with you there as well. And also, we just want to let you know, if you'd like to get connected and you'd like to work out some of the faith things together that we talked about, if you're new to faith, we have a alpha starting in just a couple weeks, a great opportunity to explore faith groups, 21 days of prayer. Again, a great opportunity to allow God to shape you into who you've meant to be. So that's happening tomorrow, 6 a.m. for the following week until Encounter next week. So I want to encourage you with that. But as you go, I bless you with the truth that you're pressed, but you're not crushed. You're perplexed, but you're not in despair. You're persecuted, but you're not abandoned, and you're struck down, and you're not destroyed. I bless you with that in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.